Everybody, we are back. We're ready to go. We see BD. BD's relaxed today. He's ready to go. He's lounging.
Chilling.
He's chilling today. So today we got a special episode. This is going to be a really good episode. Caused a lot of controversy, I believe. So first thing first, though, guys. Welcome to Tate Don't Lie. It's your favorite Raiders podcast. Subscribe. Hit the like button. If you don't, you know, hit the dislike button. If you don't like it, give us that content. Make sure you guys come and watch this. You know what I'm saying? You know, keep pushing this, you know, share this. You know what I'm saying? I know we don't drop all the time. And, you know what I'm saying? We're not dropping 11-minute videos all the time. But, you know what I'm saying? We're out here giving you that good Raiders content, good podcast stuff. You know, we're going to rev it up for the season, give you guys a whole bunch of new stuff. And we're going to do some different things, too. I think you guys are going to be excited. So what we're doing for the season coming up. So. Make sure you guys hit the subscribe button. We appreciate every single one of you guys enjoying it. Definitely see that you guys like the concept stuff that we've been doing. So really appreciate it. But today, one thing I forgot though, make sure you follow us on Twitter at the Mark John NFL for me at BD Williams 18. BD Williams started a little storm this week. He entered the car atmosphere. So go ahead, check that out, that tweet, and all the replies to that. So I had to mute
that. Like, there's too much. There's too many comments. You know, not all of it was was even football related. So I had to mute it.
Call your first names.
I knew people were gonna get mad. Carr is such a sensitive subject. You know, he's a sensitive subject for some reason. And I don't quite like fully understand it, to be quite honest with you. I really don't. I don't get it. I think that a lot of fan bases would, you know, envy quarterback stability, you know, but I understand no playoffs, no Super Bowls. So everyone's up for, being critiqued. So, I mean, I guess I understand that aspect of it.
It's just reputation. He has a bad reputation on Twitter, reputation online. He has a bad reputation. I mean, it's basically what it is. I mean, so it doesn't matter how well he plays. He can't get past the reputation of the guy who throws it away on a fourth down. So it's reputation. I mean, that's what all quarterbacks are anyways. I always talk about quarterbacks with perception. I mean, because people think Kyler Murray is top 10 quarterback. And show me something. Somebody show me why he is top 10 quarterback. I mean, he's an average, super average ass passer. But if you talk to the normal fan, they're going to put Kyler Murray as top 10 quarterback. So, you know, it's perception to me. I mean, that's what it all is. I mean, there's some guys that everybody can recognize, but once you get to the tier two guys, I mean, everybody has their thought process, you know, like, cause Kirk Cousins gets the same shit that most other people get. So, you know, that's what it is to me. It's perception. He's the guy I threw away on fourth down. People can't get past that, you know, no matter how well he plays. I mean, that's who he is. So that's kind of what I want to see. But then you added me, man, and they started adding me, man, and I got guys telling me that audibles are, you know, they should be audibling from the five. You're like, you know what I'm saying? Just next time, don't add me, bro. That's all. Don't get me involved.
Did I get you involved? I didn't get you involved in that, did I? Did I add you?
Yeah, you added me. Say, oh, Marcus said they did this in the red zone.
Oh, yeah.
I did say that, but like,
man. I did do that. I didn't want to claim that I did the study on the red zone offense. You know, I like attributing, you know, where the credit is due. You know, you did the study in the red zone. You know what's going on in the red zone.
Yeah, but you know what I'm saying, with the. I know, it just gets crazy. It's just funny. All right, anyways, today we are doing a Raiders all-time team. Yeah, guys, we're going Raiders all-time team. So we got two teams. We did a little draft. So we did a Raiders all-time draft here, basically. You know, I drafted some players, you know, every position, defense and offense. And we basically got two teams, and you guys let us know. Who is better and who is not better? You know what I mean? Like, who has the best teams. Kind of like the mock draft, you know, and which I won pretty handily, obviously.
You won the mock draft. You won the mock draft. So I feel good. I feel good about this one. I think I got you. I think I got you here. Okay. So no, but it's a great little.
All right. We'll see.
this is a great little you know, change up. There's editing film, you know, finding all the cut-ups to that we can watch, and then not only just finding the cut-ups, but then formatting it, adding it all together, annotating it, putting the lines and the X's and O's and circling feet and stuff like that. You know, it takes a long time. So doing something like this is just it's fun for the fans, and it's a good little rest from some of our film study stuff. So hope you guys enjoy it. So why don't we get into it? Marcus drafted some all-time greats. I drafted some all-time greats. Raiders. The minimum, I just want to let people know, the minimum was 3 years as a Raider. Correct me if I'm wrong. 3 seasons as a Raider?
Yes.
That was the minimum.
Uh-huh.
Because we didn't want, you know, otherwise we'd have like Randy Moss and Ronnie Lott and stuff like that on our team, you know, and that's kind of not the point of the exercise. We want people that actually, you know, spent a good chunk of their career as a Raider or did something special as a Raider. So the minimum 3 years. So, you know, Josh Jacobs and, you know, some guys who are rookies, we probably wouldn't have drafted them anyways, but they weren't on the list because they didn't meet that minimum requirement. So, yeah. So Marcus, why don't you just talk to us? Who did you draft on offense?
All right, so let's go ahead and get this offense started here. What we got? All right. So first up, we'll go straight from the tackles, you know, and then we'll go offensive line, and then we'll go skill players here. All right, so we got offensive tackle. I got Art Shell, which is, you know, self-explanatory. Also the first black coach in NFL history.
There you go.
Yeah. 8-time Pro Bowler. You know what I'm saying? Eight-time Pro Bowler, legendary Hall of Fame tackle, Art Shell. So, you know, we're starting off the team off correctly. And then we got Donald Penn. You know, we got him, right? And you got Barry Sims, right? You guys remember Barry Sims from the early John Gruden days. And you got Donald Penn from the Jack Del Rio days. You know what I'm saying? Who was also a Pro Bowler. So we got some Pro Bowlers over here. We got nine. We got nine Pro Bowls between the tackles, right? And then we got Wayne Hawkins. You know what I'm saying? That's 5 Pro Bowls. You know what I'm saying? Wayne Hawkins played from 1960 to 1969. He's an original Raider. That's an old school AFL Raider who had 5. You know what I'm saying? 5 Pro Bowls. You know what I'm saying? Then we got Kelechi Osemele, who, you know, he has a Pro Bowl as well. You know what I'm saying? He's got a Pro Bowl under his belt over there. And then we got Gabe Jackson, you know what I'm saying, as the other guard, you know what I mean? 2 Pro Bowls. So I'm loading it up here. I think it's kind of interesting that the linemen from the era of Carr, I guess I would say, is, you know, there's some really good linemen in Raiders history here. You know what I mean? So really good players. And we got Dave Dalby. You know, Dave Dalby made a Pro Bowl. You know, he's got 3 Super Bowls rings. Dave Dalby is a legendary center for the Raiders. So, you know, I got a pretty good offensive line, man. I think we're all right. I don't think you're getting through this. You know, I don't, especially passing. You know, Rich Gannon's about to have a field day. You already see my quarterbacks are. They're about to have a field day. All right. And then I got the wide receivers. I got Tim Brown. That's self-explanatory. You guys know Tim Brown, Hall of Famer, 1,000 catches, yada, yada, yada. You know, Tim Brown, 9 Pro Bowls. You know what I'm saying? Took a little too long to get in the Hall of Fame, in my opinion, but we're there. You know what I'm saying? Then we got Michael Crabtree, who is our Raider favorite from recent. You know what I'm saying? 25 touchdowns in 3 seasons for Michael Crabtree as a Raider. And we got Warren Wells, you know, the deep threat for actually our quarterback, which we'll get to in a second. We got Warren Wells, legendary deep threat for, you know, the bomber, you know what I'm saying? And then we got Fred Biletnikoff, of course, 6 Pro Bowls. We got a Super Bowl for Fred Biletnikoff. So definitely are stacked there as well, guys. We're pretty stacked here at the skill position, I believe. And then we got the running back. I got Marcus Allen leading the way. You know what I'm saying? Hall of Fame, all the Pro Bowls. You already guys know Marcus Allen, what, like 146 touchdowns in his career. You know what I'm saying? That was with Al Davis kind of, you know, getting mad at him and putting him on the burner. So who knows how many touchdowns,
who knows
how good Marcus Allen really could have been, right? Who knows, to be honest. And he had the MVP in 1985. So, you know, that's a legendary player right there. Charlie Garner, you guys already know, he made his way, was definitely a dual threat for the Raiders, passing and catching in the John Gruden era, for the first John Gruden era. And you got Darren McFadden, who got injured and got ruined by, them going from outside zone scheme to a power scheme when they have an outside zone back, which I don't understand why they ever did that. Because then you watch when he went to Dallas, he had 1,100 yards again. Whoa, crazy outside zone scheme. He's really good. So Darren McFadden, I think he had a chance to be a really good Raider, but he still had some good moments here and had some really great memories, especially like 2010 when he balled. He got the Broncos game. That was a crazy game where he just dominated. Yeah, he just dominated. So definitely some legendary moments for Darren McFadden. All right, and then quarterback, we got Rich Gannon, who is my favorite Raiders quarterback of all time. I really love Rich. I think he's from 1999, 2002. He was the best quarterback. He was top five quarterback in football. And with Brett Favre in their primes and, Peyton Manning has coming up. You had Kurt Warner's, quarterbacks like that. And Rich Gannon was up there with all of them at that point, that moment in time. And he had four all pros, right? Not four. I mean, two all pros, four Pro Bowls during that time. Like, he was fantastic. Like that 4 years, is probably, besides Stabler's, that 4 years in between, that's definitely the second best quarterback in Raiders history when you come to stats, right? And you got Daryl LaMonica, the original. He has two all pros himself. He's the mad bomber, So yeah, Daryl LaMonica, we're set of quarterback guys here. And then of course at tight end, we got Dave Casper, right?
Okay.
Legendary, ghost to the post, right? And then we got Todd Christensen. Right. Which is, who still holds the Raiders record for most receiving yards by a tight end. He's still over Darren Waller. He was the prime receiver for those 1983 teams. Those 80s Raiders teams when they moved to L.A. I mean, he was one of the prime, targets for them, or their main target, actually. So definitely a legendary tight end for the Raiders. So that is my all time team for offense. So what do you think, BD? Are we just gonna go to your team? Are we just gonna start?
We can react in between.
Okay.
Your tight ends are legendary, amazing. Uh-huh. I'll admit you got me beat there. Okay, Dave Casper, legendary. Christensen, legendary. So, those are pretty awesome. Tim Brown's my favorite. Raider, probably all time, to be honest with you. That's the first jersey I ever owned, was a Tim Brown jersey. He's my favorite player growing up. I like your receivers. I like your tight ends. You're definitely an offense guy. You know what I'm saying? Like, when we were drafting, it was really funny. When we were drafting, I feel like I was drafting defense first and you were drafting offense first. So
it just goes. Probably.
Goes with our personalities.
Yeah, because I definitely am stacked because my defense is I don't know about my defense, but we'll see. You know what I mean? we'll see how the defense goes. But my offense is stacked, bro, because my offense is so stacked. We'll win, especially in the NFL these days. I'm passing league. I'm passing all over you, bro. Marcus Allen can catch. Charlie Garner can catch. I understand what you would do.
Wait till you see my defense.
We just spread you out.
Wait till you see my defense before you say you can pass all over me. All right. Okay. But here we'll do my offense here. Let me get into it here. All right. So first things first, starting at left tackle, Henry Lawrence. Henry Lawrence was the starting T tackle for three Raiders Super Bowl teams, okay, from 1974 to 1986. Only made the Pro Bowl twice, but, you know, he was a consistent guy for the Raiders, started a bunch of games for the Raiders. And then as at guard, okay, the legendary Gene Upshaw, a man that needs no credentials. Everyone who's a football fan, not just a Raiders fan, a football fan, knows the name Gene Upshaw, starting at guard. And then also almost as legendary, maybe just as legendary, starting at center for me is Jim Otto. You know, Jim Otto was one of the original Raiders when they weren't in the NFL, they were in the AFL. He was like on every all-star team in the AFL. And then when they came to the NFL, he was, you know, a multi-time Pro Bowler before he hung it up. I also have Don Mosbar backing him up at center. Another Super Bowl champion, three-time Pro Bowler, Don Mosbar. And, you know, back in the days of Jim Otto was like a 250-pound center, you know. So if we need some beef up the middle, you know, I'll throw Mosbar in, 6'6", 305, okay? And then at guard, I got
Steve. Okay.
You know what I'm saying? At guard, I got Steve Wisniewski, you know.
Okay.
Another
okay
guy who just, you know, never got hurt, started so many games for the Raiders, incredible player for the Raiders. And then his nephew, yeah. I have his nephew backing him up, Stefan Wisniewski. I think that was like one of my last picks was Stefan Wisniewski, and I realized that I didn't meet the quota for linemen.
Yeah, that's a reach, bro.
It was well, that was like the only one left. Okay, you took Gabe Jackson and Kelechi Osemele at that point. And then starting at right tackle, I got Lincoln Kennedy. Okay, I think that, I mean, and you know, even You can be a young Raiders fan and know about Lincoln Kennedy because he does so much like media stuff with the team. But Lincoln Kennedy was another guy who he played his best football as a Raider. He came to the Raiders like later in his career and he played his best football as a Raider. I think they moved him from guard to tackle, which is like a rare kind of transition. And then backing him up, I have Jared Veld here, which is another guy. Look, if we need some extra beef, we want to go have an extra tackle in the game, we put Jared Veld here in there, okay? That's a guy who's moving people around, all right? You could have a worse backup tackle than Jared Veld here, right? And then at wide receiver, I got speed. I got a lot of speed at my flanker position, okay? Cliff Branch, another legendary Raiders wide receiver, you know, one of the fastest guys maybe to ever play football. Cliff Branch, incredible player. Rest in peace, Cliff Branch. He passed away earlier this year, right? Or 2020. And then backing him up, I have James Jett backing him up. And this is, again, you know, at this point, you took Warren Wells, and I think that was my target. But I still like James Jett. I think this is one of the last picks. But I got him up. I snatched him up. Then at running back, look, I know Bo Jackson doesn't have any records for the Raiders, okay?
Yeah.
But we're just playing one game, okay? And one game with Bo Jackson in his prime, he could take the game over. Give me some Bo Jackson, okay? One of the best athletes to ever walk on planet Earth, Bo Jackson. And then I also got Napoleon Kaufman backing him up. I mean, Napoleon Kaufman's like fourth all-time rushing leader for the Raiders history. I was actually like earlier this year, I was watching some Napoleon Kaufman highlights, and I was like, oh my goodness, this guy is – he was nasty. He was nasty for a second, you know?
Oh, yeah. I used to love Napoleon Kaufman when I was a kid.
For sure. Yeah, for sure. When I was a kid, Napoleon Kaufman was the goods. And then I got a little wild card here, okay? And bear with me here. I'm going my third running back, Marcel Reeves. Okay.
Okay.
Now, why am I doing that? Well, first of all, he could play fullback. If I want to get into two back formations, I can use Marcel Reeves as a lead blocker. He could line up at the Y. He could line up out wide. He is a Swiss Army knife in the offense. maybe not. Maybe it's a stretch to call him a Raider great, but in a game where you need some – shoot, we need some guys playing special teams in this game, right? Is it just a scrimmage? I'll put Marcel Reese out there on the punt coverage team, all right?
Okay.
But I always admired Marcel Reese's versatility. Now quarterback. And I think that this is where we're going to get into, like, some of the controversy, right?
Yeah, for sure.
My starting quarterback is Ken Stabler, okay? I think Ken Stabler is the best Raiders quarterback ever, okay? You know, he did a lot of special things, and it was against some incredible teams at the time. You know, I also love his personality. He was such a you know, gregarious personality off the field too. Awesome player, Ken Stabler, Super Bowl winner. Now, I went with Derek Carr as my backup quarterback because Derek Carr is, you know, he's the all-time leader in, you know, passing touchdowns and yards and everything like that. So for a backup quarterback, that's great, right? Like, you know, that's what you want. You know, you want a guy who can get it done. Passing the ball.
Way to sell it, bro. Way to sell it.
But Marcus is laughing right now because he's like, look, you know, people are gonna get mad because you didn't pick Jim Plunkett. And no disrespect to Jim Plunkett, I love Jim Plunkett. Actually, he's actually one of my favorite Raider players ever. But you know, I feel like Ken Stabler is a superior quarterback to him, and I think that Derek Carr is a better passer than Jim Plunkett. So that's just my two cents on that.
All right.
And then I got Raymond Chester starting as my tight end, starting at the Y. Raymond Chester, he started his career with the Raiders. He went to a Pro Bowl every year he was with the Raiders. He was also, you know, he's a solid tight end in the NFL. Mm-hmm. And you had already taken Dave Casper and Todd Christensen at that point. And I'm like, okay, I need a tight end. And I'm figuring one of those guys is going to be available, but you took them both. So I had to get Raymond Chester. Okay. And then I got, as my second tight end, I had to get Darren Waller because to me, like, after those three tight ends in Raiders history, I thought Darren Waller was probably at this point already proven to be like the next best guy. And, you know, he's a playmaker. He's a game changer. He's big, he's fast, he's tall. He does everything. Yeah. As a backup tight end, come on, you know, gotta go for that. And then, you know, this might be a little cheating. This might not be in the spirit of the exercise, but I got Jerry Rice starting at wide receiver for me. You know, when he was with, across from Tim Brown, playing with Rich Gannon, Raiders got to the Super Bowl. They got deep in the playoffs with Jerry Rice. So he does deserve credit for being a Raider, even though the majority of his career he was with the San Francisco 49ers.
He was a great Raider.
He was a great Raider. Yes.
Yeah.
It wasn't. Sure. He was. It's not. He's not just a Raider, obviously. Yeah. And he spent 3.5 years, so he just made the cutoff. When we made the cutoff, I thought that Jerry Rice wasn't going to be eligible, but then I remembered that he did play 3.5 seasons for the Raiders.
Yeah.
And then my backup to Jerry Rice is Amari Cooper. It's actually funny because Marcus and I were just having a conversation about Amari Cooper earlier today. But I mean, Amari Cooper's nasty. You know, when Amari Cooper wants to come play and he wants to play hard, he's a sick wide receiver in the NFL. So that's that is my offense. You know, do you have any reactions besides Jim Plunkett being omitted?
Besides that, which I mean, I can't wait to the comments or if this goes on Twitter. I can't wait. I just can't wait for you to get killed. So besides that, which you know, because it's not even about you getting killed about that. I think it's the balls you had to do it. Because I probably think it, but I wouldn't have done it. I would never have done it. Because it's like, is Carson Wentz better than Nick Foles? Yes, right? Or is Ron Jaworski better than Nick Foles? You know what I'm saying? But Nick Foles won a Super Bowl. So, like, Eagles fans are going to be like, so I just, you know, that's, hey. But yeah, I was talking about Jerry Rice is like Well, I remember, like, when I went back last year, I watched all, like, basically all the 2001 Raiders games. I just could not believe how well he got open, bro, at 40. Like, it just tripped me out. Like, you just imagine a 40-year-old lining up in front of you and just giving you that work, bro. And just, I mean, it was just crazy watching that. Like, he's 40 years old. I mean, maybe 39, but he was 40 in 2002. So, he was just getting open. Like, he was 20, and it was crazy. Like, that's why I think he's the GOAT, because he watching him at 40 and playing like he's 30 and still getting 1,100 yards and still getting open and still beating guys deep. It was weird, man. He's just a freak, bro. So, he's not even a freak, but he is a freak. So it's weird. But yeah. Yeah. I mean, your team's all right. Your skill position's all right. You're okay. I mean, you're not passing. Let's say that. You're not passing.
Well, hey, look. I am gonna pass. Okay.
All right. Yeah, Jerry. I mean, you gotta
because bar, yeah. when they see your defense, they're gonna realize why I'm gonna pass. Okay.
All right. Okay. All right. So let's keep moving. Let's go to my defense here. We'll go to my defense. That's fine. All right. I mean, like, I don't think my defense is that bad. I think in the secondary, we're okay. I think we're all right. I mean, I think we could stop you. Just now that I'm looking at it, I think we're all right. I mean, safety is a little worried, but, you know, we'll be okay there. We got some good safeties there. All right, so we'll start off outside linebacker. We got Rod Martin, bro. Like, you know, Rod Martin, you know,
yeah,
Super Bowl MVP. You know what I mean? Yeah,
right.
You know what I'm saying?
Three interceptions in one Super Bowl. Record.
So that's a record, right? Rod Martin, he's special. You know, it's probably why Eagles fans don't like Ron Jaworski now that we think about it. But but yeah, he's two Pro Bowls. I mean, he's got a Super Bowl with the Raiders. Actually, I think two. I think he was in there at 83 too as well. So
yeah,
he's got two Super Bowls there. So you know, we're starting off right, guys. We got Rod Martin. And then we got Khalil Mack. You know what I mean? Khalil Mack, two-time All-Pro. He's a three-time All-Pro with the Raiders. You know what I'm saying? So definitely a special talent. But, of course, had that infamous trade. You know what I'm saying? And we haven't seen our team get that many sacks since then. But you know what I'm saying? I mean, Khalil Mack definitely can rush the passer. Let me get my boy Chester McLaughlin, which I used to love Chester McLaughlin when I was a kid, bro. I was so mad when he went to the Chiefs. I was pissed. I was so mad as like a 13-year-old kid when that dude went to the Chiefs, man. I remember this. Like, why are you going to the Chiefs? Like, I thought he stabbed me in the back. You know what I mean? So,
yeah.
Or maybe it was the opposite. I don't know if it was the opposite, but, you know, he stabbed me in the back, bro. I feel like I was stabbed. I feel like something was taken from me when Chester McLaughlin went to the Chiefs. I remember it. But, yeah, Chester McLaughlin, definitely a great defensive tackle for the Raiders. I thought he was like one of my favorite players growing up. So, really, really love Chester McLaughlin. Four Pro Bowls, three-time All-Pro, bro. That's what I'm saying. They let him go to the Chiefs, man. I was pissed. All right, and then Russell Maryland, he played for the Raiders for a little bit. You know, definitely a good defensive tackle, too. I really like Russell Maryland. I mean, he had his better days with the Cowboys, but he did play well for the Raiders as well, lining up next to Chester McLaughlin. All right. Then you got the crazy John Matuzak. You know, you know, I think John Matuzak was a better commentator on NFL films than he was a player, but I think he still was a legendary player for the Raiders over there. So definitely really, really good player on those legendary Raiders teams that were just full of crazy people. You know what I mean? So, and then we got defense, and we got Ted Hendricks. You know what I mean? Hall of Famer, Ted Hendricks. You know, he's got, what, two Super Bowls with the Raiders. You know, he played for a long, long time for out there. He played Unicorn. Oakland, L.A., right? He got three Super Bowls.
Unicorn,
right? He's four Pro Bowls, two All-Pros, Hall of Fame, right? So I'm not looking that bad on defense. I don't know what he's saying. And, of course, I got Lyle Zato at defense end, too. You know what I'm saying? So we're going to get crazy. We're going to knock your head off. At least we're going to knock your head off, right? And then we got Lester Hayes at cornerback, the legendary Mr. Stick'em. You know what I'm saying? 13 interceptions, should be in the Hall of Fame. It's ridiculous that he's not, but whatever. You know, you don't want to put everybody in all the Raiders players in the Hall of Fame, you know what I'm saying? Because he got that legendary tandem with Hayes and Haynes. We all remember that, guys. Hayes and Haynes. You got that legendary tandem right there. Mike Haynes, who is in the Hall of Fame, is probably because he only played for the Patriots. First of all, but you know what I mean? I'm not going to get into that, right? The Raiders Hall of Fame, you know, conspiracies, but you guys know what I mean. All right, Mike Haynes, he had 3 Pro Bowls, you know what I'm saying? 2 All-Pros with the Raiders, you know, of course, 1 Super Bowl, part of that legendary Super Bowl team, which changed them, which kind of lifted them, the defense, to another level when he had that trade, but still gave them another good years with Lester Hayes or their legendary tandem. And then, of course, you got Nnamdi Asamoah, who's a, you know, Raider favorite, you know, was there when the Raiders were really bad, you know what I'm saying? You know, but then he got shipped off to the Eagles and was asked to play his own coverage and didn't fare very well because he was definitely a lot better in press man. But, you know, Nnamdi gave some great years for the Raiders, right? And then we got Lionel Washington, you know what I'm saying, playing corner over there. I mean, Lionel doesn't have too many you know what I'm saying, but he did play for the Raiders for 10 years. So I mean, Lionel was just there. He's just steady. He's a solid guy. You know what I'm saying? He's just he's called him a lunch pail guy. You know what I'm saying? You know, bring his lunch pail to work, show up, right? Safety. All right, so you got Van McElroy, who had 31 interceptions in 9 seasons, had 8 interceptions for the 1983 team. You know what I'm saying? So Van McElroy, he's a, you know, had 7 interceptions in 1985. He was a ball hawk. So Van McElroy, legendary safety. So, I don't know if BD's talking about he's going to pass. I don't know how. So then we got Van McElroy. All right. And then we got Eddie Anderson, also another safety for the Raiders. You know what I'm saying? It was some Eddie Anderson. I'm not too familiar with Eddie Anderson. I'm not going to lie to you guys. I'm trying to figure out, find some stats for you here, guys, with Eddie Anderson on here. Yeah, he didn't have a Pro Bowl or nothing. So, Eddie Anderson, you know, right. And then, you know, Michael Huff, you know, yeah. You know?
Yeah, I told you.
But he's not starting, guys. He's not starting. You know what I'm saying? He's a substitute safety. You know, probably play some special teams for us. So, Michael Huff isn't starting. He's not starting, right? And then we got, Villapiano, who's a legendary linebacker. I watched that 1976 Super Bowl. And, man, that dude made, like, a bunch of plays. He caused a fumble at the goal line. And so he was just a playmaker, great, great linebacker. Got that Super Bowl, 4 Pro Bowls. He's a legendary. All Raiders fans know him. He's super outspoken. You see him on, like, every single time the Raiders talk about something. So is a really good stuff. And then we got Kirk Morrison, who was a good, I think he was underrated, whether, you know, the Raiders defense, you know, had some good moments when he was there. But it was mostly he was on bad teams. I mean, he's like the Andrew Walter days and like the Jamarcus Russells and, you know, who knows how quick Kirk Morrison was or how good he would have been if he was on a better team. You know what I mean? So I thought he was a good linebacker, but I was always a fan.
Yeah,
I was too. I thought he was a good linebacker. He just has some really bad teams, bro. So, all right, man. That's my defense.
All right.
So, what do you think?
Well, look, Lester Hayes, Mike Haynes, fantastic. You know, and your front four, that would be tough to run against. Those are some crazy, just disgusting, violent human beings on that front four that you got there. So but I think that you got some weaknesses at safety, you know, and I'm gonna be run, you know, Jerry Rice is gonna be running down the seam. Okay.
Okay. All right. You know,
Darren Waller coming to the game, you know. No, but yeah, lot of Raider greats there, obviously. Mike Haynes is also probably one of the best cornerbacks in history of football.
Yeah,
Because he played for like multiple years. Like he was a veteran by the time he came to the Raiders. And he was one of the best. You know, he had Pro Bowls and everything like that with the Patriots.
Yeah,
he had a long career. It's like a really long career. It's almost like a 16-year career or something like that he played in the NFL. Someone in the comments will tell me the exact amount of time, but yeah. Mike Haynes is one of the best cornerbacks in history of football, not just the Raiders. And then obviously Lester Hayes is, you know, legendary as well. So I love your corners.
Okay. Yeah, man. I see now I'm watching this. I have so many bad memories of like Chester McLaughlin. I really loved Chester McLaughlin as a kid, bro. And he went to play for the damn Chiefs. I was so mad about that as a kid, bro. I was just, he's a traitor, bro. He's a traitor. All right. BD, all right, BD, I think it's your up. It's your defense. What we got here?
All right, so you know, I'm gonna start on, you know, not probably the weakest link in the chain here. Okay.
Okay.
starting as my at my outside linebacker position, I have Thomas Howard. Now, Thomas Howard with Kirk Morrison, those were like the best players on the on those defenses back back in those days, you know. Yeah. Thomas Howard is a guy who was like an insane athlete, never got a Pro Bowl, anything like that. But I was always a fan of Thomas Howard. This was another pick late in the draft, and I needed a linebacker. So I said, okay, I'm going to go with Thomas Howard. I need a guy who can cover, who can run around. Now, starting at D end, Raider legend, okay? Something like 83 sacks in the all-time, one of the all-time leaders in NFL history, not just Raiders history. Howie Long, starting at defensive end for me, okay? He can rush the passer. He can set the edge. He can play inside. Howie Long, beast of a man, Super Bowl champion, okay? Now, another guy, Darrell Russell. Darrell Russell, you know, again, this might be just some, like, you know, me having fond memories as a kid, but Darrell Russell was such a beast, you know. He obviously passed away too early, and he never really got it figured out. But one game, Darrell Russell is an absolute monster. And I was always a big fan of him. Incredible talent, just never like completely got it put together. But
yeah,
I'm a Darrell Russell truther. And then I got Tommy Kelly. Tommy Kelly is top 10 all time Raider in sacks in Raider history. Okay, so Tommy Kelly was a guy who was like tall, but he was heavy. So is he a defensive end because he's like 6'6"? Or is he a defensive tackle because he's 300 pounds? You know, he was kind of like a tweener kind of guy. And I think that kind of versatility, if you have a guy in there, he can back up multiple positions. Tommy Kelly on an all-time Raiders defense. I like Tommy Kelly for that. And then Richard Seymour, another guy, came to the Raiders late in his career. He was already, you know, a great player, but he did some really good things for the Raiders. He's an all-time great player as well, and you know, just in football in general. And he did some really good things with the Raiders, which is seen where he went to a couple Pro Bowls as a Raider. And then as my rush ends, okay, we're bringing the heat. Okay, Greg Townsend, over 100 sacks, all-time leading sack artist, Raider history, Greg Townsend, okay? Incredible, phenomenal player, best pass rusher in Raiders history is Greg Townsend. And if you're too young to know about Greg Townsend, look him up, find out about this man, Raider legend. And then his backup is Derek Burgess. Now, hold on, Derek Burgess. Okay. His only Pro Bowls he ever made were as a Raider. Okay. He led the NFL in sacks in 2005 in his first year as a Raider when he got 15. Okay. Not even Khalil Mack had 15 sacks as a Raider. So Derek Burgess as my backup defensive end, Howie Long, Greg Townsend, and Derek Burgess. I'll take that any day of the week. Okay. We're getting after the quarterback with these guys. Now, starting at corner for me, Charles Woodson, you know, probably if not the greatest defensive back of all time. He could play, he played every single position in the secondary during his career. You know, including coming back late in his career and playing safety for the Raiders, which, you know, some of our younger, you know, audience might be more familiar with Charles Woodson, the safety, but he was also a Pro Bowl cornerback in his early years. Incredible, incredible talent, incredible athlete, Charles Woodson. I got him starting at corner in his prime for us. And then I got Stanford Route backing him up. I'll be honest with you, Raider Nation. I thought I picked all my corners. I thought I had everyone picked. And by the time Marcus, you know, caught up to me with drafting corners, I realized we didn't really have – it was slim pickings. But anyways.
Stanford Route.
Stanford Route is a special teams player. We will not even get into dime personnel. He is a gunner on this team, okay? But he had Stanford had like one good year. He had like one pretty darn good year as a Raider, but that's it. And now starting at safety, look, if you can't get past my corners, because when I get to the other side, you're gonna see. But even if you do, I got Jack Tatum in the middle of the field. Okay, ready to literally break your neck. Okay, one of the fiercest hitters in history of football, Jack Tatum. I think they like changed rules about football because of Jack Tatum. He was such a such a fierce hitter. Real quick side note, I went to Passaic High School. I live in New Jersey. I moved here. I moved to the East Coast like 10 years ago after I graduated from high school. But I went to Passaic High School to talk to the coaching staff about, you know, potentially, you know, working with them and their football team a few years back. And they had a Jack Tatum jersey up. And I was like, wait, Jack Tatum is from New Jersey. And I looked it up and he went to Passaic High School and they had his jersey up there. I thought that was pretty cool. Which also I think is another reason why, believe it or not, I see a lot of Raiders fans in New Jersey. Getting back to it, I got Greg Beekert and Matt Millen as my starting inside linebackers. Are they going to cover anyone? No, but again, they're going to kill you. Okay. If they come across the middle, Greg Beekert, like he was a stalwart, you know, starting inside linebacker for the Raiders for a long, long, long time, you know, and, Matt Millen was also one of the, you know, he was the inside linebacker, starting inside linebacker on the Raiders Super Bowl teams. So I think I got some good leadership. I got some good, you know, some fierce hitters across the middle there with my line, with my two inside linebackers. And then the other safety is George Atkinson, you know, another Raider great on Raiders Super Bowl teams. George Atkinson. It was funny. Marcus sent me a clip of Raiders running, you know, going up against who are they going up against? That clip that you sent me?
Super Bowl 76.
Super Bowl 76. Okay, yeah. So
Super or Bowl. Super, not Super Bowl. I don't know whatever Super Bowl number is, but when the Raiders won the Super Bowl,
yeah, and 76. And you know, George Atkinson and Jack Tatum were in coverage, and Jack Tatum didn't look hot in coverage, but. But George Atkinson, he has some good footwork, really smooth transition. George Atkinson, you know, and again, all time great. He was on all those Raiders defenses that won those Super Bowls, right? Mm-hmm. And then backing him up, I got Mike Davis. This is my Eddie Anderson pick because I don't know honestly. Mike Davis. Here, I think that I learned something about Mike Davis, and then I was like, okay, I'm gonna pick him. So that those are my safeties: Jack Tatum, George Atkinson, and Mike Davis going across the middle there. And then on the other side, I got Willie Brown. Okay, Willie Brown invented the bump and run, right? You know, he was a former linebacker, and they wanted to play corner. That's like back in like the 60s when you could do something like that. Yeah. And he was like, okay, well, I'm obviously, you know, not going to be able to run with these guys. I gotta, you know, be violent and throw them off their spot. So he invented press coverage. Willie Brown, another Raider great, fantastic Raider, you know, one of the greatest Raiders plays in history when he intercepted, had a pick six in a Super Bowl. Willie Brown, great player. And then a very, very underrated Raider, Terry McDaniel. Terry mm-hmm. McDaniel, you know, he's super underrated. He's he did a lot for the Raiders. He went to a couple Pro Bowls. I just feel like Terry McDaniel's pretty underrated. He was like one of the best players on that defense during the early 90s when he went to 5 Pro Bowls. He was an All-Pro 4 times, okay? And people don't know about him, or you know, the younger audience doesn't know about Terry McDaniel. So you know, for me, I'm gonna get into nickel. Terry McDaniel is gonna be in the slot. Maybe Charles Woodson will be in the slot. Okay, Tatum, George Atkinson. You know, and I got that pass rush. My pass rushers. Okay, my guys that are rushing you combined as Raiders have over 200 sacks in their careers. They're getting after you guys. Okay. You're going to have to put Daryl LaMonica in. We're going to injure Gannon. All right.
I don't know. I feel like my line's good enough, bro. I got a good pass blocking line. If anything, you know what I'm saying? You're not going to be able to get to it. You're not going to be able to get to the passer. I think, you know, I got Art Shell on one side. I got Donald Penn on the other. I got Rodney Hudson in the middle, you know, so nobody's getting past Rodney Hudson in his prime. And you know, him pass blocking. They got Wayne Hawkins, man, too, man. You know what I'm saying? I know he's never blocked with his hands before, but you know what I'm saying? He's gonna be good, you know what I mean? You know, because they couldn't block with their hands till 77, but still, he'll be excited because he can block with his hands. So he'll be excited that he can grab somebody.
Do you think Donald Penn is gonna stop Greg Townsend and Howie Long, bro? Get out of here, all right?
Yeah, I mean he was stopping Bosa, you know what I'm saying? Who else did he stop? I mean, the AFC West, man. They were pretty damn good, bro. Donald Penn and like Gabe Jackson, Ronnie Hudson, that 2016 season, bro, they were ridiculous. All of them. So, I mean,
all right.
Yeah, okay. They're ridiculous.
But. So we'll leave this up to the audience to decide who they think had the better draft, Team Marcus or Team BD. All-time Raiders draft, all-time Raiders greats at every position. If we miss one of your favorite all-time Raiders, Bill Pickle, Mark Van Egan, there's a couple guys that, you know, didn't make the cut for whatever reason. You know, yeah. We're not trying to offend anyone. You know, we literally just did it while we were supposed to be at work, and we went back and forth. And so we apologize if we offended you by leaving any of your favorite Raiders off the list, but just let us know who has the better team. If these two teams went up against each other, who's winning? Let us know. All right, Raider Nation.
Yeah, for sure. That's crazy how some of these guys are not in the Hall of Fame. Like, how's Steve Wisniewski not in the Hall of Fame? 8 Pro Bowls as a tackle, as a guard.
As a guard, yeah.
That's crazy. Dude, Terry McDaniel has 4 All Pros.
4 All Pros, bro. 4-time All Pro.
Yeah. That so you're the best corner in football for 4 years, because it's not even like a Pro Bowl. A Pro Bowl, you could get like, you know, you could be like the third best corner in the league, right? But you're the like 4 All Pros is a lot, bro. That's Hall of Fame. I don't care. Like, that's a lot. Holy man, I don't know, that's crazy. I'm just looking at it. Like, I knew Terry McDaniel was good, but I just like, bro.
4-time All Pro is like, come on, that's crazy. That's crazy. You know,
nuts, bro.
Yeah. So, any other Raiders related news before we get out of here, bro?
Any other Raider related news? What else we got? Nothing really. I mean, the OTAs are starting. They got OTAs. You know what I'm saying? You know, I'm sure somebody's shining. I think mini camps next week. But besides that, bro, ain't nothing really special happening over here. I mean,
yeah, it's been pretty quiet, right? I just wanted to see if I missed anything.
You know, I stopped paying attention to OTAs because I remember Jerron Kreiner used to like kill it like every OTA in minicamp. Like, is Jerron Kreiner gonna take the step? Like, I remember he's like every minicamp while he was on the team, he just blew it up. So, and ever since then, I just never cared about minicamp that much.
Do you remember that route that he ran against Cliff Harris, Oregon corner? Do you remember that?
Is this in college?
College, yeah.
Nuh-uh.
Jerron Kreiner had one of the sickest routes I've ever seen in college. And everyone was talking about how this guy, I'm pretty sure that's Cliff Harris, the Oregon guy. He was like a return man, but he got in trouble. But he was like an incredible, phenomenal athlete. And he hit him with this real chill, out and up, and just put Cliff Harris, you know, mixed him up. It was a sick route, one of the sickest routes, but didn't work out. But I can see why he was killing people in the OTAs. You know, I could see why, because he was a good route runner.
He's just murdering people. That's funny. But yeah, ever since then, I really haven't cared about OTAs, but we'll see.
No one notable got like cut or traded. Julio Jones, you want to talk about Julio Jones going to the Titans or anything like that?
I mean Julio Jones going to the Titans, it's interesting. I think it's gonna be interesting. I think the whole offense is gonna be interesting because they got Todd Downing, and I think Todd Downing's been getting jobs convincing people that he could run the offense that was there before.
Right.
Because I don't understand why he keeps getting a job. Because that's the it's like the same thing he's doing with the Raiders. He's basically saying, like, the offense isn't changing much. It's like, so like he basically convinces his coaches that he's not gonna change the offense, but he's gonna keep the same offense because he's not an offensive mind. Like, I don't get why he keeps getting the job. Like, is he like offensive mind somewhere? Like, I don't know. Maybe, I mean, Arthur Smith was good, I guess, but like, I don't know. I never really, I watched Ryan Tannehill. I never really liked the scheme that they ran. I feel like it was like really simple. Like it was basically they had Derrick Henry. So if they did play action, everybody bid on it. So then they ran the same like over route to AJ Brown over and over again on play action because it was always open because people, the linebackers had to respect it because they, if they didn't, then they're getting ran all over them. So they had to come up to play Derrick Henry and they just throw it over the middle. And then
they run so much Yankee. They might as well be called the Yankees.
Exactly. So it was like, I don't know. And if Todd Downing's going to do it, he's not going to do it very creatively. So it's going to be interesting what happens with Julio over there. I mean, if I was in fantasy, I don't know if I'd take Julio that high in fantasy anyways, because he doesn't score a lot of touchdowns. But one, they're not going to pass a lot, right? Two, I mean, he has A.J. Brown over there, and I think A.J. Brown is getting better. I think he's beating press a little bit better, but you know what I'm saying? He's mostly an over route guy still right now, and after the catch, yeah, guy. Right. And then Tannehill, he just, you know, I don't know if Derrick Henry has a bad year. I mean, the offense is not going to do anything, but, you know, I think he would have been a great fit for the Raiders if the Raiders actually went into it, because the Raiders need that. They need an X that can like get open for sure. And
they can win on the outside.
Like for sure. Like 100, like we, like everybody believes that he can't, you know what I mean? Like, you know, the guys that we have right now is like, can they, maybe they can get better. Like, no, like Julio, he's going to win outside. So, you know, it's, and that's what the Raiders are missing. I mean, besides Darren Waller, you know, they don't have somebody that could really, really for sure that we believe in can win outside like every single time.
And so, I'm honestly not convinced that Darren Waller can like consistently win on the outside, to be honest with you. Like, if you line Darren Waller up at the X, right? Mm-hmm. And you got three receivers on the other side, okay? And he runs a fade or something like that, you see those passes get broken up to him.
Yeah.
You know, like, he's not like consistently like snagging those. So, you know, that's my thing about Darren Waller. I think he's a tight end. Like, he works better across the middle of the field. Because he's got that speed, and you get matched up on him and he just runs away from you, and he's got such long legs, like no one's catching this guy, you know. That's where I think Darren Waller does his best, and it would complement the offense greatly if someone could just start winning on the outside.
Yeah.
So we'll see who that is. I agree, Julio, he's a beast. You know, he deserves a lot of all the praise that he gets. You know, they don't make wide receivers like that, you know. Like, this is a rare profile of an athlete, you know, on top of, you know, some of the crazy, like you see him, like the toe taps, you know, the toe drag swag, sideline catches and all this stuff. You know, he's a consistent winner on the outside, and he's a really good route runner on top of it too. But, you know, it didn't happen. It didn't seem like the Raiders were even in the running for it. So no. I know that I tweeted this out because I heard on a Raiders podcast, Scott Gilbranson's Raiders podcast, a Falcons like reporter talked about how Julio Jones didn't practice very much. And I was like, look, you know, right or wrong, does that sound like someone that John Gruden is going for, you know? Yeah. So I don't know if that has anything to do with it at all, you know, but yeah, at the end of the day, it didn't happen. So, you know, and here's my thing too. Yes, Julio Jones gives the Raiders someone who can win on the outside. Great compliment to Darren Waller, right? And the run game hopefully is better this year. Okay. Mm-hmm. But then now we're waiting another year, another 2 years for Henry Ruggs, because if Julio Jones joins the offense, Henry Ruggs ain't getting any targets.
Yeah.
I mean, he's not going to become a volume guy. It would just be maybe like a couple big shots here and there, you know, to keep the defense honest. But now that, you know, This is Henry Ruggs needs to be a volume guy this year. Like that's the next step for him. You add a big profile wide receiver like that. Now Henry Ruggs is just still like a gadget deep threat guy. He's not like a volume receiver. So
yeah. But that's what I'm saying. Like for Ruggs to be that, he's got to win outside, bro. Like, so hopefully he's gotten better there that he can win outside. Because if he consistently win, then it's basically over. But I mean, I'm not talking about just winning over the top. I'm talking about like winning everywhere. Like he just wins, and like Carr can count on him to win. Cause I think when people talk about like Crabtree or whatever, or, you know, even when he was playing with Coop, you know, cause I went back and watched the 2016 games a little bit too. I mean, he could count on those guys to win. I mean, that was kind of like, that was why he was able to throw outside more and throw to wide receivers is because they won. You know what I'm saying? They would win consistently. They would go out there and, you know, they would give him plenty of space. He could miss, but they would, since they won, they could come back and make a tough catch or anything like that because they won the route. And I mean, that's what really the Raiders are missing. And they don't have that guy that can win. They don't have like Davante Adams. They don't have that, you know, even Justin Jefferson, he wins like crazy, you know, like they don't have that. They don't have that guy that can just, you need, it's one-on-one. I mean, that helps in the red zone too. That's the problem with some of the problem in the red zone too. They don't have somebody that can win, you know, because in the red zone, I mean, you going against Davante Adams in the red zone. I mean,
you got to double him. You have to.
Because if you don't, you know what I mean? Yeah. It's slim picking. I mean, he's gonna eat you up. I mean, he's gonna fade you, he's gonna slant you. It doesn't even matter what. I mean, he's gonna eat you up probably.
Yeah. So, and then what does that do? You gotta double him, you gotta bracket him, you gotta do something. Okay, to take it away the slant and the fade.
Yeah.
And then that means one less defender in the box, the run game opens up because the box lightens up. It has a ripple effect. So I 100% agree with you. Raiders need to have, like, someone needs to emerge. One of these wide receivers needs to emerge as a guy who can consistently win on the outside. But I just want to point out, you know, 2016, the way that Amari Cooper and Crabtree won was on the outside. So where did Derek Carr? He threw fades. That's what he did. Now, where do these guys win? You got Hunter Renfro and you got Darren Waller. These guys win across the middle. So that's where Derek Carr throws now. You know, and so like that, Derek Carr's got thrown to the guys who are winning, and right now the Raiders only have guys who went across the middle. But yeah, like that's the next element of this defense. Tyrell Williams wasn't ever really that guy. To me, I thought that Tyrell Williams won more across the middle anyways on posts than he did like as a jump ball kind of receiver. Brian Edwards has some good film in college doing stuff like that, you know, so we'll see. But someone's got to emerge because – That's what this offense needs. That's the next step this offense needs.
That's exactly what it needs. Somebody can just win, bro. And then and then it would help everything. It would help everything. So for sure.
Because you can't play if you're not worried about the receivers winning on the outside, you can play single high, right? Because that means your corners are one-on-one on the outside. So if you play single high, that means you have eight in the box. Okay. And that's what it's really not that big a deal. Now, if as a defense, you're like, oh, wait, these guys win, you know, on the outside. Now you got to go too high, right? And now it opens up things. So 100% agree. That's what the Raiders need. They need a guy who can win on the outside. Hopefully that's Henry Ruggs and Brian Edwards this year, but we'll see.
Yeah, for sure. All right, besides that, man, I ain't got nothing else.
I mean, that's probably enough. That's probably enough things that we were talking about there. But that's it, Raider Nation. We appreciate you guys for tuning in. Thank you for bearing with us. I know we had a longer hiatus than we usually do. But thanks for tuning in when you saw that this video went live. Make sure you tell your friends, ask your dad, ask your uncle, ask your grandma, ask them about these old all-time Raiders that we talked about today. And tell us which team that you like the best. Follow myself on Twitter at BDWilliams18. Follow Marcus Johnson at TheMarkJohnNFL. Hit the like button. Hit the subscribe button. Turn on post notifications. Raider Nation, we out.
Peace.